Greetings and welcome to the lecture on development of DNA and RNA vaccines. In this lecture, I will discuss the history, design and development of DNA and RNA vaccines and the regulations associated with RNA vaccines as well as DNA vaccines. This is intended as an introductory lecture. More details will be covered in subsequent lectures. Today we are going to learn about the different types of vaccines, the design elements of vaccines, the development of vaccines, as well as some of the regulatory processes involved in vaccine development. You will be able to apply what you have learned during the course of your career or in the case of your integration into a facility which is involved in vaccine design and development. We will first look at the different types of vaccines. According to the World Health Organization, vaccination consists of stimulating the immune system with an infectious agent or components of an infectious agent modified in such a manner that no harm or disease is caused, but ensuring that when the host is confronted with that infectious agent, the immune system can adequately neutralize it before it causes any ill effect. Now, this is the World Health Organization definition of vaccination. It's pertinent to note that the word no harm has been used, and no harm relates to no morbidity and no mortality, or at least a limited morbidity. The history of vaccination is something which we need to look at in detail in order to understand our current perspective. There are records of vaccination in China and in the United Kingdom or in England in the early part of the 1600s and also the 1700s and 1800s. However, this was not recorded as a scientific experiment, and Edward Jenner was the first researcher who inoculated an 8-year-old child and who observed certain developments in immunology with regard to the process of vaccination. Subsequently, vaccination developed in response to the challenges of pandemics, and Louis Pasteur developed the attenuated rabies vaccine. Waldemar Hafkin conducted trials with the cholera vaccine. This is one of the first trials in which he used control and test populations. And finally, one of the breakthroughs in vaccine was the cultivation of the polio virus in non-nervous cell culture, for which John Enders and his team were awarded a Nobel Prize. Now, one of the famous vaccines which was developed was the one which was used to treat polio by Jonas Salk, and he is famously quoted with this particular statement when he was asked who owns or what is the patent on the vaccine. He said, "Well, the people own the vaccine, I would say. There is no patent. Could you patent the sun?" And this showed the magnanimity of his spirit in the development of the vaccine as a tool for the eradication of polio. Now, if you need more interest in vaccines, I provided a link, and this will provide you with a link to the history of vaccination. Now, in order to understand vaccination or the process of immunization, it's pertinent to look at Koch's postulates, and the four postulates are relevant to our understanding of the process of immunization and the identification of the causative agent. The general approach to vaccine production involves various steps. The first is the culture of the virus or the pathogen or the biological agent, as the case may be, either in cell lines or as in this example, using embryonated eggs. Alternatively, vaccines can also be cultured in bacterial cell lines as well as in yeast or other organisms. The next step involves the purification of the antigen from the accessory proteins and the compounds which are associated with the developmental platform or the production platform. Purification is one of the vital steps in which endotoxins and other proteins, which may be potential antigens, are removed from the vaccine formulation. And finally, the vaccine is formulated with adjuvants and stabilizers, as the case may be, before it proceeds to the next step, which is the mass production. Now, adjuvants are commonly used in vaccination formulations. An adjuvant is an ingredient which is used in some vaccines that helps create a stronger immune response in people receiving the vaccine. These can be in the form of organic or inorganic compounds, as the case may be. Finally, the vaccine is produced by scaling up in a bioreactor and packaging and distribution via the cold chain, or in the case of lyophilized vaccines, at room temperature. Now, let us look at the various kinds of vaccines. We first have the virus, which can be in the live, killed, or attenuated forms. So live attenuated vaccines are produced by the culture of the original strain of the pathogen, followed by attenuation or weakening of the pathogen, which is done using chemical compounds. Attenuated virus elicits an immune response but does not cause morbidity or mortality in the host. And finally, the host does not transmit the pathogen to other individuals. Inactivated vaccines are based on the original vaccine or the original pathogen, and they are developed by weakening the pathogen using chemical compounds or heat. The immune response is robust and there are fewer side effects. Recombinant antigens are the vaccine of choice in the case of mass production of vaccines. So one of the type of vaccine which is a recombinant vaccine is a subunit or conjugate vaccine in which specific antigens or antigen coding genes are selected from the pathogen. These genes are then cloned and expressed in cell lines, bacteria or yeast, and then the antigens are purified and formulated. The efficacy depends on the post-translational modifications such as glycosylation or refolding of the proteins. Now, there are advantages and disadvantages of subunit vaccine. The first one is the speed of production. So antigens can be cloned and expressed rapidly, they can be purified, and they can be used in the event of a pandemic, as the turnaround time is short. However, there are issues associated with the vaccines themselves. The first one is endotoxin contamination, or contamination of the accessory proteins from the host or the platform. Then we have the refolding issues with antigens, which cannot be refolded in prokaryotic hosts. Glycosylation, post-translational modifications, and codon bias in the bacterial host. Now, DNA vaccines are another promising type of vaccine. They are produced by engineering a plasmid, which contains the complete set of features required for expression of the target antigen in the host. The plasmid DNA construct is designed and developed using a synthetic biology approach. The plasmid is cloned into E. coli, and the plasmid is purified and formulated for vaccination. Now, there are certain advantages and disadvantages of DNA vaccines. The first one is, again, rapid production and low cost, because the plasmids can be cloned rapidly in E. coli. The disadvantage is the DNA vaccine must be delivered into the cells and eventually into the nucleus for the translation of the target proteins. It should also be displayed on the surface of the cell of the host. Now, DNA can be degraded by host DNases. Endotoxins may be carried over from the production process, and in some cases, the host may produce antibodies against the plasmid DNA itself. RNA vaccines have gained precedence in the current pandemic situation. Now, in the case of RNA vaccines, the production strategy is similar to DNA vaccine. The target antigen is cloned onto a plasmid. However, there is a T7 RNA polymerase binding site upstream of the antigenic principle. Now, this plasmid is linearized, and the entire process of RNA production can be carried out in a in vitro environment. So generally, a polymerase such as a T7 RNA polymerase can be utilized to produce RNA fragments which represent the transcripts of the original virus. Now, these transcripts are fused to the internal ribosome entry site as part of the gene construct, and when this RNA transcript is introduced into the cells, it is translated into the respective protein. The RNA must be stabilized, formulated, and used as a vaccine. So in this case, we have advantages and disadvantages. The most promising advantage is that the vaccine is again produced rapidly. It can be produced in vitro and has a very little contamination from the accessory proteins. The disadvantage is the degradation of the RNA itself. So the host RNAs can degrade the RNA, and then there can be issues with regard to transportation, which must be done using a cold chain. Modifications at the 5' and 3' ends of the RNA may be necessary in order to prevent the degradation of the RNA by the host RNases. Viral vector vaccines are based on the Trojan horse concept. So these are based on the adenovirus. In this case, the adenovirus vaccine uses the genome of the adenovirus and replaces specific genes with the antigenic principles. So in this case, we have an adenovirus which has a genome of 26 to 46 kilobase pairs and contains 23 to 46 protein coding genes. Some of these genes or the gene coding regions can be replaced with the genes from the antigen of choice. So the antigen is then translated by the virus itself. Because adenovirus is a double-stranded DNA virus, the chances or the likelihood of it getting degraded by the system, by the host system, are lower. The adenovirus can be injected into the host, and we then have the transcription and translation of the proteins as the case may be. We now look briefly at the regulatory process. So the regulatory process undergoes these following stages. We have the exploratory stage, in which case you develop the concept of the vaccine, the preclinical stage, in which testing is done using animal models, such as the murine model. Then we go into clinical development, the four stages: regulatory review and approval, manufacturing, and quality control. Now, one of the important elements of the developmental process is the clinical development. So the phase one involves testing in small groups of people. Phase two involves a larger group of people. Phase three, in which it is distributed over a larger population size. And finally, in phase four, there's a follow-up and reporting of any adverse effects. So in the phase one trials, we actually ask these questions: is the vaccine safe? Does it seem to work? Are there any serious side effects? And how is the size of the dose related to side effects? In phase two, the trial is conducted across a larger population size, and we look at the most common short-term and long-term side effects and the response of the volunteer's immune system. This can be done by studying their antibody profile. In phase three, we move into the next element, which is the larger population set. The safety of the vaccination, the effectiveness of the vaccination in terms of the immune response, and the most common side effects. So finally, we go on to phase four, which is the post trial phase. In the phase four, the long-term effects are tested or ascertained across the population. A vaccine will be approved by the FDA when it's safe and effective and the benefits outweigh the risks. In the case of pandemics, there is an emergency use authorization, which is basically FDA may allow the use of unapproved medical products or unapproved use of approved medical products in an emergency to diagnose, treat, or prevent seriousness or life-threatening diseases or conditions where certain statutory criteria have been met, including that there are no adequate approved and available alternatives. So EUA is generally resorted to in the case of a public health emergency. Finally, we have to look at the National Pharmaceutical Regulatory Agency, which is the agency in Malaysia which approves vaccines. Each country will have its own regulatory authority, which derives its approval from adequate guidance and prior records. There are some companies which I have referenced to in the links, which are the clinical trial companies. Finally, to summarize, we have looked at a brief history of vaccination. We have looked at the different types of vaccines. We have looked at the design and development of vaccines and the regulatory procedures. If you need any more information, you can attend the complete lecture series. And thank you for watching, and I hope this lecture has been useful for you. Stay safe.